So, as the PowerPoint says, wait, I have to make this smaller so I can see. The talk is called The Impossibility of Acknowledging Difference. And what I'm going to try to do is kind of look at how the Western philosophy tradition has looked at the issue of universality and difference. And kind of as a topic that they always return to in different ways. And I will do so by concentrating on a few people from the 20th century mainly. And it's really important to me to see them as like they are critical of this tradition or like engaged with it critically, but they do so from squarely within the tradition. So these are like internal critiques to Western thought, but they don't actually try to go beyond that tradition. And so this works, yeah. By way of introduction, I will turn to the work of Jacques Derrida on friendship. And then this will lead me to the main part that is about Stanley Cavell's talk or work on Other Mind Skepticism. And then the last part of this talk actually will make quite a big jump, as it will then turn to issues I'm working on at the moment, where I'm, as you maybe know, work on at the Institute for Sustainability Studies. So at the moment, my work is more on questions of climate change mitigation. And here I'm engaging, or just starting to engage with this Anthropocene narratives. And interestingly for me, a lot of the issues that I worked on before kind of come up there again in different terms. Okay, so Derrida describes this book that you see here, The Politics of Friendship, as an essay which resembles a very lengthy foreword to a book that he hopes to write sometime in the future. By repeatedly returning to the exclamation, "Oh my friends, there is no friend," which is quoted and re-quoted in the canon of Western philosophy, he discusses what he perceives as the tension within Western thought and within discourses of friendship. And the importance this has for kind of ideas of political community in the Western tradition. One of his central arguments is that in the Western tradition, friendship is understood in terms of sameness. In The Friend, Cicero, for example, writes, "We would encounter our own ideal image." The friend here is, in Derrida's words, the same and not the other. When friendship descends from the ideal of an extraordinary, exclusive, unique bond between two people, where there are two souls one soul living in two bodies, exactly, to this more like mundane idea of friendship that holds together a community, this idea of sameness collapses into kinship, into the familial, and that is most importantly for Derrida, into the fraternal. The political discourse appealing to birth, to nature, or to the nation, this familialism, Derrida points out, consists in a renaturalization of what he calls the legal fiction of kinship and brotherhood. Enlightenment universalism inherits this long-standing understanding of sameness as brotherhood. Commenting on Michelet, Derrida argues that the alleged universalism of the French Revolution's discourse on equality retains a notion of fraternity, which is formulated by way of an exemplarist logic in which we have recognized the profound strategy of all nationalism, patriotism, and ethnocentrism. In this exemplarist logic, the French, or at least European, white propertied man, who is supposedly capable of rationality and of the pursuit of knowledge as objective and universally valid, is taken as the example for the universal human being, against which all others are measured, found lacking, and thus excluded from the category of the political right-bearing subject. The universalism of fraternity then relies on the exclusion and production of the other. This internal other of friendship and the political, Derrida points out repeatedly, is woman. Women cannot or cannot yet be friends. They cannot be part of the political community. As Derrida writes, a political phallogocentrism has, up to this point, determined its cosmopolitical democracy, a democracy qua cosmofratrocentrism. The virility of political friendship at times needed to be explicitly stated in the Western tradition. In particular, when a move towards universalism seemed to open the door to the political arena to excluded others. More often, however, exclusion functions through the natural absence of women, of female friends and sisters in the famous texts of Western thinkers. While the fratriarchy may at times include cousins and sisters, Derrida writes, including may also come to mean neutralizing. Including may dictate forgetting, for example, with the best of all intentions, that the sister will never provide a docile example for the concept of fraternity. We might note here that these exclusionary tendencies actually were already contentious topics in the 18th century, but that in the later engagement with Enlightenment values in the 19th and 20th century, and I would include parts of Derrida's work here too, the emphasis has tended to remain on the white male propertied figure of the Enlightenment, and therefore early critical contributions to modern Western thought by women and people of color, and the importance of historical events like the Haitian Revolution has remained largely excluded from mainstream academic debate until quite recently. For the purpose of this talk, however, what I want to note is just that Derrida argues that in the Western tradition of thinking about friendship, what one desires to encounter in the other person, in the friend, is ultimately another self, or at least a brother. It is thus with other versions of oneself that the universal community of human beings is imagined. So to me, Stanley Cavell talks about quite similar issues than Derrida does, but he goes about it from a different angle. And so his point of departure in the work I want to look at now is the problem of other mind skepticism. The challenge of skepticism has been surprisingly persistent in the history of modern thought, Western thought. As Lillian Allroyce writes, philosophy constantly urges us to reflect on the possibility that we may be completely and utterly on our own. It instills in us the horror scenario that all the human beings who have informed our lives, our friends, our lovers, and our family, are in truth mere automata. René Descartes, the looming founding figure of modern thought, she argues, was the first to introduce us to this scenario. And so Descartes wrote in the Meditations on First Philosophy, if I look out of the window and see men crossing the square, as I just happen to have done, I normally say that I see the men themselves. Yet do I see any more than hats and coats, which could conceal automaton. I judge that they are men. Descartes' observation has come to haunt modern philosophy, also because Enlightenment thinkers were so taken with the idea of the human body as a machine. For example, a French physician and philosopher, Julien Offray de Lamartine, famous for his work L'Homme Machine, written in 1747, described the human body as a machine which winds its own springs. And maybe as an aside to this here, this idea of the machine as this like imposter of the human is really popular all through modernity, but only in the 19th century it kind of takes on a more sinister note. And at the same time, it also, that's when it becomes more gendered. And I always find it quite interesting that in modern science fiction, there's like all these figures of the human-looking Android or later than AI. That is this woman. And so, for example, in novels like Philip K. Dick's Do Androids Dream of the Electric Sheep, which inspired the Blade Runner movies, or in Battlestar Galactica or Ex Machina, again and again, there is this question asked, how can I be certain that this figure, who looks like a conventionally beautiful young white woman, is actually human and not a robot or an AI? Or if I actually know that she's not human, maybe how could I know that this artificial thing still can think and feel similar to myself? But back from this to Cavell, even though skepticism about other minds is usually understood as a danger or seduction of philosophical thought, which needs to be avoided, Cavell does not actually set out to refute other mind skepticism. For him, it is so obvious that we can never fully know what goes on in another's mind. It is such a trivial statement that we should rather wonder why modern philosophy is so obsessed with it. This obsession to him is linked to the modern idea of knowledge, which Ludwig Wittgenstein has called the craving for generality. So in other words, knowledge has to be 100% certain in any circumstance, or it is not knowledge at all. The problem of other mind skepticism is thus not the finitude of knowledge, but it's a problem of modern epistemology. So while Cavell accepts that we can't know everything about another mind, he wants to limit the claim of skepticism. But we might not be able to know everything about the other, there are some things we can know. He agrees with Wittgenstein's understanding that body and mind are not separable entities, as Descartes would have it. Wittgenstein argued that the body is the best picture of the human soul, which means our bodies, if we want to or not, betray something about our mental states. And if that is only in the very least that we actually have mental states. As Cavell writes, the body, to have a body is to be condemned to expression, to meaning. I actually wanted to leave that out, but because it came up this morning, I want to say a little bit more about this. So for Cavell, he writes that the banality of other mind skepticism is like shown when we ask, like, who doesn't know that what I go on in knowing others is their outward behavior, or is it their conduct, or the subtler movements of the body, especially the face, and as documentary filmmakers insist upon, the hands. In his reading of Shakespeare, Cavell asserts that one's relationship to the other has always a bodily dimension. As he points out, the annihilation of the other is epitomized in what happens to the other's body, as when Othello's imagination turns Desmondema into alabaster and Leontes' faith or credulousness turns Hermione back into flesh. So again, here it's like the imagination of the other as the other, as a woman, turns first their body into stone or back into flesh, depending if we understand that body and mind are connected. So for Cavell, when we know that, the more interesting question is, what does the skeptic actually crave? Why do they want the certainty? Alweis argues that the skeptic hopes that by finding out somehow that the other is like themselves, they would be rescued from the horror scenario of existential loneliness. However, for her, the skeptic is actually mistaken in thinking that that would be the case. To the contrary, if knowledge were possible, it would make the existence of others impossible. She writes, if we subscribe to the skeptic's view that it is possible only to obtain knowledge of the existence of others when we are able to take over, annex, or at least become united with another person's mind, we undermine what defines our relation with others. And she continues, this shows confusion on the part of the skeptic, On the one hand, she yearns to escape the threat of solipsism, the thought that she may be the only human being on earth. On the other, in her desire to escape solipsism, she seeks to convert the other into something that is compatible with and indistinguishable from herself. Yet that would mean that in the end, the skeptic's desire is solipsism and not knowledge of other minds. The other is only granted existence when she is divested of everything that makes her other. To me, this discussion has important parallels with Derrida's discussion of friendship and universalism as a desire for the other to be another self and for the homogeneity of political community. Similarly, Immanuel Levinas criticizes the Western philosophical tradition as a mode of thinking that aims to reduce the other to the same. He writes of the movement of human thought that by knowing aims to domesticate everything and incorporate it into its own venue, to make it fit into preconceived concepts, principles, and theories. As Michael Morgan writes, Western philosophy's primary impulse is imperialist, to reduce the other to the same, to think everything. So we might ask why this mode of engaging with the world is so seductive. And one answer that I think is given over and over again by 20th century thinkers is that the idea of generalizable knowledge allows for the successful manipulation of the world, where our material environments become controllable and usable. Moreover, by making our relationships to other people about objective knowledge, the actual risks or challenges they pose to ourselves are minimized. In that sense, framing the other as a problem of knowledge allows the self to deny its relational and thus vulnerable and finite character. This later point is also what Cavell explores in his work. To him, the skeptical mood arises from the real risk or danger our relations with others inevitably entail. Other mind skepticism, then, is an excuse that would allow the skeptic to deny and retreat from their relationship with others. It can be reframed as an unhappiness with the actual state of human relationships, which are not about knowing or being certain, but about acknowledging. Acknowledgement for Cavell entails recognizing that the other's pain or need are forms of address which require a response. However, he also points out that any response, any form of communication, always carries the risk of miscommunication and of disappointment. We should take this risk, Cavell argues, because acknowledging our existential relationality is crucial for making sense of ourselves as a moral subject, and even in a way for any form of meaning at all to exist, because for him, meaning is always a communal activity. So while we have the choice to refuse to acknowledge relationality, this refusal also leads to a diminished form of existence. Because Cavell insists that we are always already in community with others, and the task is to acknowledge and to negotiate this existential fact, most of Cavell's writing revolves around situations where people find themselves in a pre-existing relationship. So he writes mainly about stories of love, of relationships, or friendship. So about situations where, in a Wittgensteinian term, we would already share a form of life. So we speak a common language or share certain assumptions and values. And then in this situation, we run up against these limits of commonality. The encounter with the irreducible alterity of another person is then the unexpected insight that this community or intimacy is limited, that one's own assumptions about the loved other are fallible. In these cases, acknowledgement involves openness to the unexpected difference of the beloved other person. Put differently, acknowledgements involves less the suspension of doubt about the other's mind than the suspension of judgment. In their engagement with others, individuals not only learn where mutual understanding ends, they also learn how far they are able to cope with this difference and how well they are able to accommodate otherness. Cavell tends to give quite mundane, but also somewhat uncanny or strange examples to make his points. And one he gives, for example, is, if you deny that I have eaten all of an apple because I have eaten the core and the seeds, I can perhaps accommodate to this. That is, I can perhaps grant what you mean, and in future, unless I myself change to your way of thinking, remind myself to avoid around you the topic of eating apples. But, he writes, if one day you deny that I played all of Brahms' violin sonata in my recital because I played only the violin part, I may well not find myself willing to judge things so as to accommodate you. To Cavell, these examples show that we don't have to talk to everyone about everything, but that there seem to be some things we do have to talk to someone about if we are to talk to her or him about anything, as for example, what we know or believe and what we can see and hear. This situation, however, where one is unable to further assume community with another person, neither marks the end of community nor of reason as such. That individuals find that they do not see the world the same way or understand a concept in the same way, and that they can give no reason for why they see or understand in the way they do, does not imply that there is no fact. As Cavell writes, I recognize that the other must find her own way out of her isolation, as I must, and while words are in such moments pointless, they have not vanished. They can seem solider than ever. While individuals find themselves always already in community with others, the social nature of embodied existence, of language and meaning, does not preclude the pervasive possibility of isolation and loneliness. The point is that we need to find our way out of isolation again and again, thus reaffirming our connection to others and to the world. Finally, for Cavell, encountering the other teaches us about ourselves as moral beings. We learn about how far we can accommodate difference and also whether we are able to explain our own responses to ourselves. In the end, what we might learn in such encounters is that we have not just been mistaken about the other, but that we have actually been mistaken about ourselves. While Derrida's discussion of friendship focuses on sameness as an overarching theme of the Western tradition, he also seems to argue at some points that this insistence on sameness and on the natural connection actually arises from a distrust of fraternal unity. By organizing the whole text around the quotations of, "Oh, my friend, there is no friend," mistrust of friendship is revealed as a central theme of the Western tradition. In Greek thought, and also in the Judeo-Christian tradition, narratives of brotherly betrayal repeatedly emerge. For a book on friendship, then, hostility plays a significant role. The brother-friend can also always be revealed to be the brother-enemy, and the homogeneous community ends up being held together, not by bonds of natural love, but by the identification of the shared enemy, which ultimately may lay hidden within. As Derrida tries to bring to the fore in his prolonged engagement with Carl Schmitt, the idea of friendship or community in the discourse of nation disappears into a politics that can only exist in its relation to hostility. In this context, Derrida asks what it would mean for women to take the place of Schmitt's ultimate partisan, given that women are the other of Western discourses of friendship. In some remarks, however, Derrida gestures towards an understanding of the other and of friendship that goes beyond Cavell's remarks on accommodating difference. Derrida raises the question how a different kind of friendship could look like and what politics would follow from rethinking friendship beyond community. For thinking non-fraternal friendship, Derrida finds one possible beginning in Kant, who introduces distance into the continuum of tradition, which is nonetheless confirmed by him. Distance here is a principle of rupture, of interruption, that can no longer be easily reconciled with the values of proximity, presence, gathering together, and communal familiarity, which dominate the traditional culture of friendship. This idea of friendship with the other, to whom a respectful distance is kept, who cannot become fully known, no part of the homogeneous we, Derrida identifies as the central question of his essay on the politics of friendship, which remains unanswered, left for a book not yet written, and only hinted at as a friendship without hearth, a friendship without presence, without resemblance, without affinity, without analogy. Along with presence, truth itself would start to tremble, Derrida writes. From such a different friendship, he hopes, a democracy to come could take form, which goes beyond current ideas of nation and pre-established community. What Derrida seems to ask when speaking of a friendship without home is what he also, at other occasions, especially in his engagement with Levinas, has formulated, where the question of infinite otherness is raised and the possibility for another way of thinking of our or of relating to the world, where the otherness of the other is left intact, it is not appropriated or annexed. How could such an otherness, which could not be preconceived or thought, be experienced? What this would entail beyond wonder or religious experience, as Levinas often seems to have it, I have to say doesn't become fully clear to me in this text. Okay, so I will actually not follow on now from this discussion of otherness in Derrida, but make a really big jump and talk about, in closing, this more things that I just thinking about how universalist claims are currently made, or how like these grand encompassing narratives are told in work on sustainability, on climate change, and especially the Anthropocene trope. So while in the late 20th century it was argued, in a bit of an overstatement, for example, by Lyotard, that the grand narratives of humanity have disappeared, I think they have gained in relevance again in recent discussions about the Anthropocene. So I guess most of you or all of you have heard what the Anthropocene is several times so far by now. But so the Anthropocene as a term designates a new proposed geological era where the human species has become a major geological force. And usually, anthropogenic climate change is seen as the most important sign of this impact of the human species on the planet. Manuel Arias Maldonado speaks of the Anthropocene turn to point out that conversation in the humanities and the social sciences is increasingly focused not on the plausibility of the Anthropocene thesis, but on the meaning and interpretation of this notion. The Anthropocene, he writes, is at the same time a descriptor for the current state of social-natural relations and an epistemic tool that invites us to see such relations from a new standpoint. The Anthropocene category as a tool, however, does not only concern how humanity relates to its natural environment. It also entails issues of imagining temporality and human agency. The Anthropocene thesis involves a notion of the human species as a powerful actor, which, speaking in geological timescales, erupted as a sudden event on the planetary scene, with the potential to massively transform the planetary future. Only by developing New modeling technology has the human species recently become aware of the scale of its impact. And this awareness, it is further argued, might allow us to start steering our tremendous powers. In what I would call the positive arm of the Anthropocene literature, it is argued that by knowing that we are in the Anthropocene, humans also gain the ability to develop true agency in terraforming Earth. As Friedrich Neirath interprets this, in this grand narrative, the human species is thought of as pharmakon, meaning both the poison and the cure. Such an understanding reinscribes the modern idea of teleological human history into the much broader temporal framework of geological deep time, in a way where development, spearheaded by an all-knowing technologically savvy elite, delivers the planet into a better humanized future. In social science and humanities engagement with the Anthropocene thesis, however, there's often a somewhat uneasy tension between this geological deep time statements and historical timescales that are suitable to describe human engagement with the environments. To make any form of political sense of a tentative geological event, we have to re-enter the much finer temporal grain of historical human time, measured in months and years and not in millennia. I do not really have time to go into this as much as it probably would be needed to be to substantiate this claim, but I would venture kind of that the scene trope from the Anthro to the Capitalo to the Stulto scene, the actual scene part of it, so the geological time part, tends to disappear into the background quite quickly. So while zooming out to this very large timescale first allows us to make these very encompassing claims about the human species as a whole, as a unified agent, for the idea to have any kind of political purchase, it then needs to be translated back into this much more familiar idea of timescales. To illustrate the maybe quite obvious point that understanding human agency in such encompassing way as the Anthropocene term invites us to do means retelling historical narratives, I will now very briefly turn to the question when the Anthropocene actually is supposed to have begun, which entails the question how the human species has become such a powerful planetary actor. Arias Maldonado points to evolutionary history to argue that there might be something particular about our species, which has predestined us to gain these extraordinary powers. For him, it is our ultra-sociality, our ability to cooperate more efficiently than other species, thanks to language and culture, as storage and transmission devices of useful information that has granted us the exceptional ability to transform, influence, and colonize nature. Other accounts of the Anthropocene, however, might raise doubts about this inborn tendency of the human species to communicate as what has profoundly affected planetary systems. There are several contenders to the starting date of the Anthropocene, and I will only quickly mention three. So in what has been called the early Anthropocene hypothesis, for example, proposed by William Ruddiman, agriculture is identified as the origin of anthropic climate change. It maintains that concentration of CO2 actually began to increase 8,000 years ago when people started to burn forests in order to make arable land. And then it picks up 5,000 years ago with the irrigation of rice fields, and there's a rise in people keeping cattle. The second storyline is probably the best known one, advanced, for example, by Strömer and Kruzen, who are often attributed as coining the Anthropocene term. They would place the starting point with James Watt's invention of the steam engine in 1784. And indeed, analyses of air trapped in polar ice show a sharp rise in global concentration of carbon dioxide and methane in the 18th century. While the first version encompasses most of humanity in slowly working their way towards anthropogenic climate change, The second version chooses Europe at the time of the Enlightenment as the cradle of the Anthropocene and links it to technological development and the move from agrarian to industrial societies in Europe. A third hypothesis, advanced by Lewis and Maslin, proposes the paradoxical date of 1610. This date is paradoxical because it marks not a spike, but a fall in CO2 emission in the atmosphere brought on by the collapse of human population in the Americas in the wake of European colonization. The unbelievable violence of European conquest, which brought with it famine and new diseases the Europeans transmitted, as well as the implementation of slavery, led the population to drop from an estimated 54 to 62 million prior to European arrival to about 6 million in 1650, so a 90% drop. While this might go beyond Lewis and Maslin's intention, retelling the story of the Anthropocene as the history of European colonialism does not only make quite a bit of sense when we look at the CO2 and methane emission records, it highlights the political and ethical implications of picking specific Anthropocene storylines. So seen from the perspective of colonial history and post-colonial theory, the European Enlightenment in the 18th century and industrialization in the 19th is not a story of technological ingenuity and progress spreading from Europe across the world, with the unfortunate but technologically fixable side effect of affecting planetary systems. Instead, violent European expansion was of key importance for setting in motion social and economic processes of industrialization. Colonial rule had lasting environmental effects around the world, from the implementation of plantation agriculture, producing the cotton and sugar, fuel for early industrialization, to the exchange of animals and plants, which at least contributes to the mass extinction events we are also becoming more aware of currently. Finally, the European colonizers violently imposed their understanding of human nature relationships, but the natural world is there to be manipulated and exploited for financial gain, and the right to inhabit land was directly linked to its exploitation. Telling a universal narrative of the human species' inadvertent modification of the planet, which has now led us to the doorstep of planetary environmental catastrophe, overlooks crucial historical and contemporary differences. Where those countries and populations most responsible historically and currently for anthropogenic climate change are the least affected. It overlooks that for many people, the unthinkable catastrophe, where the world as they knew it is destroyed, lies not only in the future, but also in the historical past and in their present. So concluding this talk on a very different note than it began, I guess that for me, this discussion of the Anthropocene and climate change relates to the notion of encountering difference because it shows an often still implicit tendency to talk about universal humanity and mean the experience of relatively rich people living in the global north. Who, for example, could deal with a 2-degree overall temperature rise, which would make much of the global south uninhabitable? Glossing over the differences of how people are affected by environmental destruction and climate change today, I believe it often linked to a willful forgetting of the European history with encountering those they have seen as others. An ethics of both universality and difference then requires us to accept responsibility in terms which consider that we all, as embodied living beings, universally share the condition of precariousness, by which I mean both physical vulnerability, the finitude of knowledge, and the need to have relationship with others, which we can never fully control. At the same time, highlighting shared affect and embodiment and precariousness to me only makes sense when we think ethical and political responsibility in terms of precarity. as the unequal sociopolitical distribution of precariousness along historical, economic, and sociopolitical lines, globally and within our local communities. While we are all vulnerable in some sense, we are not all vulnerable to the same degree. And current national and global politics, unfortunately, all too often, can be understood as a discourse of securization of some populations by the production of the precarity of others. So in conclusion, there are different narratives of universalism, from the rational human subject over the cumulative agencies of the human species to the embodied vulnerable human being, but each of them only works as long as it remains in a productive tension with notions of difference and particularity. So, and with this, I actually conclude my talk and stop sharing. Okay. Thank you very much.